I have proposed a 2-cent wealth tax.
We're going to fight for a wealth tax.
I would introduce a 1% annual wealth tax.
And a wealth tax makes a lot of sense in principle. The problem is that it's been tried in Germany, France, Denmark, Sweden, and all those countries ended up repealing it because it had massive implementation problems and did not generate the revenue that they'd projected. If we can't learn from the failed experiences of other countries, what can we learn from? We should not be looking to other countries' mistakes. Instead, we should look at what Germany, France, Denmark, and Sweden still have, which is a value-added tax. If we give the American people a tiny slice of every Amazon sale, every Google search, every robot truck mile, every Facebook ad, we can generate hundreds of billions of dollars and then put it into our hands because we know best how to use it.
Welcome to Conversations. I'm Bill Kristol, and I'm joined again, I think we've had one of these conversations, right, by Greg Mankiw, professor of economics at Harvard, author of the best-selling economics textbook for a long time, right? It's amazing. What, 25 years, something like that?
That's right.
Wow. And that's much more impressive than being a professor at Harvard. You know? The real market is speaking there, right?
Yes, absolutely.
And chairman of the Council of Economic Advisors under President George W. Bush and many other senior positions and to countless dimensions. So really one of the most respected economists in the country and respected on both sides. And I think when we had our first conversation a couple of years ago about the surprising disregard for certain what one would have thought would be certain economic truths and principles on, to some degree, on both sides of the political spectrum. And the situation's gotten worse, so we need to address this again. We need to do a better job this time of explaining to people what really is a problem to worry about and why people may be falling in love with certain fake solutions and attractive sounding things that wouldn't work. So where to begin? There's so much bad information.
Well,
out there,
in a situation now of tremendous polarization, including on economic policy, but not among economists. If you talk to economists, they kind of range from center left to center right, and you get a bunch of economists in the room, they're more likely to agree than disagree with each other. Despite the fact that political parties are pushing out to the extremes, we have Donald Trump becoming very isolationist in his trade policy, and you have Elizabeth Warren, who's becoming very populist in her attacks on the rich. And so you have sort of both parties sort of drifting apart, going to the extremes, and the economists tend to be left in the middle, being a little surprised that both political parties are abandoning them. There's sort of two bold proposals out there being debated right now. I think one of them is a good and plausible idea, and the other is kind of a crazy idea. The crazy idea, from my perspective, is the wealth tax, because I think it's going to be very, very hard to implement. Many European countries have tried it. Most of them have given it up. And there's a whole variety of problems with it. So, for example, suppose I own a chain of dry cleaners or hardware stores or something. That's my privately held business. What's the value of that? You could just sort of add up the value of my merchandise and the real estate I own. But the truth is, most of what I have is probably goodwill, which is a very intangible kind of thing, the value of the business as an ongoing concern. Is the government going to have to go in there and try to evaluate the value of this business every year? And how are they going to do that? They do that a little bit once a lifetime for the estate tax. Right. But that makes it. But it's people who study the estate tax knows that's pretty difficult. The estate tax is in some sense a negotiated tax between you and the IRS. Do you want every small business to have to negotiate every year with the IRS of what the value of its business is?
And there's no obvious way to mark to market because they're not.
Because there's no market.
Business isn't for sale.
Yeah, that's right.
If you put it for sale, you could.
For Jeff Bezos, it's easy. He has an Amazon stock, and that way we can value that. There's a market for that. But for a lot of closely held businesses, there's no market, and it's not like you can sort of put your chain of seven different hardware stores on the market and see what the price is. The valuation issue becomes very, very difficult. So I actually think the wealth tax is a non-starter. I see why it has political appeal because, as described by Elizabeth Warren, it's going to only affect 0.1% of the population. So if you tell 99.9% that they're going to get free stuff paid for by the 0.1%, that sounds attractive, but it's probably not realistic.
I mean, what I've always sort of – why it's always slightly appealed to me, I've got to say, is don't you think it makes more sense, though, than the income – I mean, theoretically, if you – leaving aside this rather big implementation problem, taxing people's wealth rather than their income makes a certain amount of sense because the income is stuff they're getting each year, which you
I'm not so sure that. I want to go back to the other good proposal for a second. But let me talk about this issue. Let's imagine you have two people who make the same income. So I have two CEOs, both of which make $10 million a year. And so they're in the top 0.1%. And you tell and one of them says, "Okay, I want to take my $10 million a year and have lavish parties, fly a private jet, and I'm going to blow it." Another says, "I want to accumulate it and invest in small businesses and eventually leave some to my kids and grandchildren and nephews and nieces and give some to my alma mater." The wealth tax says the second guy should pay more taxes than the first guy. So I don't.
So it penalizes savings.
It penalizes savings.
And the counter argument, I guess, is that if someone makes, two people make $10 million a year and one guy already has $1 billion, it matters to him less, obviously. I mean, the $10 million increment is less important, and it seems a little unfair to tax them the same, I guess, that the one guy who's making his first $10 million and the person who's making his 100th $10 million. Maybe that's a little silly. I don't know.
Let me go to the proposal that actually I'd like.
Okay.
At least I think is worth thinking about. And that's the proposal of Andrew Yang. Now, I'm not here to endorse Andrew Yang, but I think his basic idea at least seems workable to me. I mean, his idea is to put a value-added tax, which is basically a flat consumption tax, and use it to finance universal basic income, so everybody gets a lump sum back. That, I think, could work in the sense that we know value-added taxes work in much of Europe. It's a fairly efficient way to collect revenue. That's why many European countries use it and have kept using it for many, many years. Universal basic income is a pretty easy thing to implement. Everybody gets a check. They do it in Alaska, right, with the oil revenue. So the whole thing would work, and the whole thing would be progressive. It would be like a sort of a super-duper earned income tax credit, although it doesn't require you work because everybody would get it. But it's basically a way to redistribute resources from people high up in the income distribution towards people at the bottom. To me, that's attractive, in part because I think it would work, but also in part because this distinction between the two CEOs, one of which is spending lavishly and consuming a lot, and the other which is saving to give money to his alma mater, it's going to penalize the guy who's living the lavish lifestyle more. And I think that's a good thing. So I think the consumption tax aspect's quite desirable. The universal basic income part kind of makes sense as a way to help people at the bottom. This idea, by the way, has been floating around for a very long time. During the Nixon administration, there was a talk about this.
Right.
And I remember even before that, Milton Friedman talked about the negative income tax in his book in the early 60s, Capitalism and Freedom. So this idea of a universal basic income or negative income tax has been floating around for a long time. And so to me, actually, that might
You think that would be preferable to the – I mean, so I think the earned income tax credit kind of became a version of that it's limited to people's labor. I mean,
they have to work some.
Which is maybe a good thing, though, you would argue, right?
Well, you know, the question –
Or not, I don't know.
The system we have now, the social safety net we have now, says, okay, we're going to distinguish between the deserving poor and the undeserving poor. So if you work hard but have low wages, well, that's your deserving. Well, if you're disabled and you can't work, well, then you're kind of deserving. If it's a period of high unemployment, we'll extend your unemployment insurance benefits. Well, then you're kind of deserving. But other people aren't deserving. So it requires the government to draw these distinctions between the deserving and the undeserving. Does the government really have that ability to sort of fine-tune the social safety net in that way? I think it's hard to know. I mean, what if somebody has a serious mental illness? Can the government really? Right. What if they have serious back pain, which is very hard to diagnose? I think distinguishing between the deserving and the undeserving is a very difficult thing for the government to do. Now, some people are object to the idea of, well, what if somebody just wants to spend all their time surfing, right? Yeah. They're fully able.
The lazy surfer kid of upper middle class parents. Should he get
that?
Our tax money?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So I kind of understand that. To me, that doesn't strike me as a bigger problem as the government's trying to have decide, okay, well, you're disabled. You say you have back pain, but we can't really diagnose it, so you're not disabled, so we're not going to help you. So I've always been attracted, ever since I read it in Milton Friedman's book when I was a student, I've always been attracted by this, sort of the negative income tax, universal basic income idea, because because of its simplicity. It really takes the government out of people's lives, including the lives of the poor.
Now, I think Charles Murray has endorsed a version of this, but then has always said, but you need to get rid of all these other programs from his point of view,
yes.
From the sort of libertarian
point of
view.
And the Yang proposal includes a little bit of that. So if you accept what he calls the freedom dividend, if you accept his freedom dividend, then you're not eligible for certain other programs. So I don't think he goes the entire way that Charles Murray wants to go.
No.
But there's something of that in the
program. And there is something to be said, I suppose, for I mean, when you have these other programs, then you get endless disputes, gaming of the system,
yes.
What is disability, and you exactly. don't want to be hard-hearted and say no to this person, but then someone else fakes it, and then you get some government person having, or doctor having to certify something, and then the doctor's sort of
yeah, exactly. And one thing we learn is that once people become disabled, even when the economic conditions get better, they might be able to work part-time. They're disinclined to do it because they've already established themselves as disabled. Whereas this universal basic income says, no, you know, we're not going to judge you. And if you want to come back in the labor force when you want to, fine. So to me, actually, I think the idea makes sense. It would be a pretty radical change from where we are. I understand that. But I think unlike the Elizabeth Warren thing, which is also a radical change, this is what I could see working. Whereas Elizabeth Warren's wealth tax, I just don't see.
And I like this kind of headline out of this: conservative economist endorses giving money away to everyone, to lazy surfers. That's good. But it seems to me the distinction is partly, as you say, you think the Elizabeth Warren tax wouldn't work, but the wealth tax wouldn't work. But also there's kind of a distinction in the way you're thinking about these taxes, right? I mean, one of them is, I don't know how to put this now exactly. I mean, well, maybe there isn't a distinction. I'm trying to think.
It seems to me that the
you're letting the market work in the first place. And then saying, but look, some people, there should be a better safety net for the people at the bottom.
Yes.
And there's some people at the top are paying, in effect, a higher progressive.
Right.
What a VAT would be, or sales tax on those people would sort of just be an additional income. Well,
yeah, it'd be an additional tax
on that.
Yeah, but, yes. So if you're rich and you're buying that yacht, you're going to pay the value add tax on that yacht.
Right. So it's sort of let the market do its thing, but then correct some of the excessive effects of it. Whereas the Elizabeth Warren thing seems more intrusive somehow. You know, it's a real, it's really change. People who are just sitting there saving their money are not just paying interest on taxes on the interest or on the dividends or on the capital gains as they do today, but somehow are marking to market and having to give the government a chunk of their actual
yes.
resources.
Well, that's right. The people who are in favor of the Warren wealth tax seem to have this idea that some assets are pernicious in and of themselves.
Right.
They really want to get. If you read the work of Thomas Piketty and Emmanuel Saez, Gabriel Zuckerman, they really kind of want to get rid of billionaires. They somehow think of people sitting on vast sums of money is something that's a bad thing. I don't look at that and see it's a bad thing particularly. I want to help people at the bottom. I'm much more focused on what we can do to help people at the bottom, which I think is what the Yang thing does. And whereas if somebody wants to sit on vast, I mean, if Warren Buffett wants to spend, you know, he's sitting on, I don't know, $100 billion or so. If he wants to sort of sit on that, invest it during his lifetime, live modestly, and then eventually give his money to charity, which is what he's planning to do, I don't see any problem with that. I mean, that does not seem to have a problem with need of fixing. It seems like a fine thing for society. I'm more worried about people at the bottom who are losing their jobs, sometimes to trade, but more often to technology. I mean, to give you an example, there'll be self-driving trucks probably in our lifetime. Several million truck drivers will be out of work, perhaps. What are we gonna do for those people? I don't think it's not gonna be an easy problem. Are we gonna decide, okay, who can find another job, who can get another job? But as I think universal basic income says, we'll give you at least something. We're not gonna pay you as much as you earned as a truck driver, but at least you have some safety net to fall back on when you get unemployed from your truck driving job.
Oh, I dream of these people every night. The only thing I worry about is that some total unknown that nobody ever heard of comes along.